首先歡迎各位。
I would like to welcome everybody to the special meeting of the Health Services Panel of the LegCo. It is a special meeting. While we are waiting for the proper officers to take their seat, I just want to remind the participants of the following. You can use the microphone, and you may also use the earpiece and channel 0 for floor, channel 1 for Cantonese, channel 2 for English, and channel 3 for Putonghua. I would also like to remind the participants that when you address the panel, you will not be covered by the protection and immunity provided under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance. Your written submissions will also not be covered by the ordinance. Please take note of the security measures in the note for members of the public attending meetings in conference rooms or observing meetings in public galleries in the Legislative Council complex. If you need a copy, you can approach the security guards for a copy, and a copy has also been sent to you when you receive our correspondence. Secretary, would you like to make some opening remarks, or would you like to give the floor to the deputations? I'd rather give the floor to the deputations. I must apologize to the deputations. You have been kept waiting because we have overrun the first session. Each of you will be given 3 minutes. The first to speak will be Ms. Lee Wing-in. I'm from the Democratic Party. I'm a community officer. Well, the public healthcare sector is suffering from overcapacity. Now, the hospital authority is an independent statutory organization. Yes, got a lot of money, but then it's up to the HA itself to decide how to spend the money. The LegCo, as well as the government, can only exercise a monitoring role. So let me analyze the problems with the governance of the HA. First of all, I think we need to unify the services so that we can distribute the services among the needy patients. We have got the Food and Health Bureau formulating the policies. The Department of Health coordinates the health services. We have the Center of Health Protection, responsible for health education. For the hospital authority, it is independent. It is responsible for the operation of the hospitals. I think we need to have an integrated system, and they should talk to each other. They should collaborate. Unfortunately, the organizations that I referred to seldom have coordination. And as a result, the hospital authority has become an independent kingdom. And our office has received many complaints, and we are aware of unfair human resources, personnel policies, and bullying culture, etc. Say, for example, nurses at a QIC ward have been forced to spend an excessive amount of time on paperwork and make use of the yet-to-be-completed electronic system. This is being done at expense of the professional service. And in fact, for recruitment, I think they have cronyism. And then Western medicine is the dominant medicine, and I don't think doctors can manage better than the executive officers. Doctors have condoned the abuse of power by nurses. I'm afraid that there is a lack of team spirit. In Hong Kong, we have got medical professional bodies. But in the UK, Simon Siemens is the head of NHS, and he used to be a medical consultant. I think doctors are not good at management. I think it's better for them to remain focused on clinical work. We need to be strict about the time limit, otherwise we'll overrun again. Next, Mr. Chair from the Dr. Chair, Hong Kong Medical Association. Thank you. I speak on behalf of the Hong Kong MA. For the past 10 years, the government has been kind to the medical field. A lot more money has been given to us, $30 billion in the first year of the decade. And in fact, the government has been increasing the amount of money given. We have 5,000 doctors in the past. We have got 1,300 more doctors, an increase of 25%. For the past 18 years, as to the number of attendances, I don't think the number has increased. In other words, the service has not been enhanced, yet the size of the subvention has been increased. Why is it so? For doctors, we have got 1,000 more specialty doctors, 44% more than 10 years ago. And then for the A&E departments, pediatric wards and the medical wards, I think we all know about the stress points. For Dr. Wang Yam Hong at Tumen Hospital, Dr. Ma at UCH, and the panel chair is also responsible for the medical ward. You don't get any increase in manpower, so it is a matter of a managerial mistake. And then there are many problems with the management. The administration pays the hospital authority in return for service. The hospital authority should purchase the service from various departments. So the service provider should take the blame if the outcome is not good. Now, if you ask a maid to clean up two toilets, it's already difficult, not to mention a third one. Now, but on the other hand, you ask the doctors to see 20, 30 patients. Doctors don't have any bargaining power. Many doctors have become the controllers, and they can choose how many patients to see. So they don't have to get to clean up a toilet, so he would only ask the subordinates to do all the cleaning work. So the senior can go off work anytime. They don't have to be the service provider. They have become the management. They are acquiring the service from the MOs. So it's a matter of something wrong with the organizational structure. I agree with what the Democratic Party member has said. I think doctors should focus on clinical work, and doctors should help patients to improve the conditions instead of buying service from the junior doctors, in a sense. Thank you. Next, Dr. Chen. I'm Dr. Chen. I'm in the private sector. I am also working part-time for the hospital authority. I haven't got as long a speech as Dr. Xie. I just want to make two points. First of all, why the frontline doctors or junior medical doctors chose to leave the hospital authority or chose to leave their departments? I think it can be sort of alarming. You may get 8 or 10 more doctors a year, and then in 3 years' time, half of them have left. And then usually, after finishing the specialty training, another one-third will leave. Now, for frontline doctors, they find the workload unacceptable, and they don't get enough support, whether they are on duty, whether they are at the outpatient clinic, and they see that the workload is increasing all the time. Moreover, they don't get any recognition in their work. When something goes wrong, then the frontline doctors have to bear the brunt. They have to take the blame. Well, 10 years ago, a patient would get another appointment in 4 months' time, 6 months' time. Nowadays, it's 8 months later that you will see your doctor again. Now, in the past, we're able to give an appointment in 4 months' time. Now it is 8 months. It is not safe, but we allow this to happen. So frontline doctors who have the choice will certainly choose to leave. And then for those who have become a specialist and for those who have become an associate consultant, they also choose to leave because, quite unlike the old days, they are not able to get promoted and then have an easier time when they become a consultant. No, it is no longer the case. You get more pay, but then your workload won't decrease. Yes, I find it reasonable. However, if you look around and you see that in your department the workload is unevenly distributed, then you will start to think whether you should leave so that you can realize your potential. Because you think that it is unfair, and then there are so many risks. So for specialist doctors who are ready to leave, they would rather leave the hospital authority and set up their own practice so that they are responsible for their own work. Next, Mr. Yip Gam Long, Sai Wan Fei Yok Tong Lik. I have prepared a speech, but I'm not going to stick to that. Well, the LegCo has been kind enough to organize this public hearing at such an hour in the evening so that more hospital staff can make it. But you can see that they don't want to come forward. They don't have the courage to speak up. I think it has been said that within the independent kingdom of hospital authority, workplace bullying is prevalent. So if you expose your identity, if you're identified when you speak up here, then I'm sure you won't have a good time when you stay with the hospital authority. And that's why they dare not come forward to speak up. Well, I have read the paper prepared by the Legislative Council. Well, the hospital authority has got the HA board. There are annual meetings and quarterly meetings, monthly meetings, consultative committees, and then there are governing committees, hospital governing committees for 30 hospitals and cluster meetings. You are calling so many meetings, and yet you never listen to the frontline staff members when they want to tell you what they think. The management will always suppress their voice, threatening them that they're not going to have a good time if they dare to speak up. Of course, this is unspoken, but everybody knows. Well, I can tell you that for 10 years, we haven't seen any progress. In fact, things are getting worse and worse. Well, the hospitals are suffering from overcapacity. You haven't got sufficient manpower to meet the needs. When you don't have sufficient manpower, you will pay your staff members to sacrifice their leaves to work overtime. But then they are also human beings. I'm now talking about the care attendants in the wards, helping the patients to take a bath, etc. Their pay is low, and they have to go to another district to go to work. So they may get extra pay by working overtime, but then they will be too burnt out, and they may not be able to enjoy the extra pay.
Well, the officials here present, you have very highly paid. Well, would your conscience speak to you of your high pay and the present situation? I'm an ophthalmologist working a dozen years in the public hospital. My colleagues have said that HA is not a normal working place. Well, you have worked there for more than a decade of year. well, why is it not a normal place? Well, people said that you have gone into private practice. Well, congratulations. Well, in fact, for the HA service, after 10-year service, we are very well paid. In fact, we could not earn as lot as if I had stayed in the HA. I am not a talent, but I studied very hard, and I went into doctor training. I sacrificed a lot of social life. Well, for the doctor's students, we could nowhere be seen when we were in the university. We have physical and mental stress. Well, it is we have to run through a gauntlet to be a doctor. Why is it that we cannot take it anymore? I started about 30 patients, and then it went up to 60 patients a day. Well, there is a few minutes only for the for each patient. Well, whatever errors that happened, I was to be blamed. Well, I have undergone more than a decade training. I don't want to treat my patients, 100 patients a day with only a few minutes for each. And for the private clinic, I only see 10 patients a day. Well, outpatient in the public hospital, we only have a few rooms available. Well, the administration gives allocations for the hospitals, then you have to increase the number of patients that you treat. So very often, you are really squeezing the staff in terms of money, in terms of rest days. Well, HA, well, if you want to really serve the public, then you have to really go to the front line. I'm a member of the Pharmaceutical Association. Now we have more and more patients, but the workload is increasing all the time, and the patients are not enjoying the normal standard of service. Well, I suggest that we should have pharmacist-led clinics, because there are not enough medical personnel in hospitals. Patients have to wait a long time. Well, they can first see a pharmacist. They can check whether the drugs are properly used. So that would also help the patients to follow the protocol. Reports show that in the States, the clinics led by pharmacists, for instance, for high blood pressure and pains and tumors treatment, etc., that proved to be effective. Well, pharmacists can provide drug service. First of all, they can do a medical reconciliation. They would record the drugs that have been used in the hospital, a complete list, and also can have a comparison of prescriptions. And this medical reconciliation is a very important part for drug management, so that the doctors can do the best prescription. Well, there are errors of double taking of drugs, sometimes that could lead to deaths. And there are also review from the pharmacist that would ensure that clinical taking of drugs are appropriate. And after discharge, they could also give advice. They can explain the drugs to the patients, the side effects, etc. And when the patient is discharged, they would also the pharmacist would also provide a full list. So pharmacist-led medical reconciliation would reduce the differences in the drugs, and also they would also reduce the possibility and the rate of errors. Mr. Chen Kalok, well, let me declare interests. From 2005 and 2006, I worked for the HA. I was in the non-emergency ambulance service in the Princess Margaret Hospital. Well, recently we have heard of a lot of stress for the medical personnel, chiefly speaking about doctors and nurses. However, the supporting staff on the front line have been neglected. Even for the supporting personnel pushing the patients' beds, they have been outsourced. And security in the hospital is also being outsourced. And for the ambulance service, most of the service belong to the hospital. However, HA had considered outsourcing the ambulance service. But fortunately or unfortunately, after the SARS in 2003, it was not outsourced because the colleagues have put on their masks and transported the SARS patients at the risk of their lives. Well, why is it that they have such a high morale? Because they were permanent staff, and the hospitals would stand up for them for life, in fact. However, now they are contract staff. As well, how could they be of high morale? And that would include me, because the director of a service would be lower than normal, ordinary staff and of the old regime. For those staff in the hospital, whether they are medical or supporting staff, we have so far not received enough respect. Nurses would take a passage what they shouldn't take in the parking lot, but and some mishaps had happened, but we apologized. In fact, now we could buy better equipment, 2D and 3D equipment. Well, 3D equipment are more accurate, and we lack personnel also in the radiation department. We hope that better equipment could be provided. Mr. Ng Kin Wah from Lion Rock Institute. Hong Kong has a very severe doctor manpower. It's because it's a protectionism. They have created a lot of barriers to reject non-locally trained doctors. We can see that in many clinics, well, they put up their certificates from Scotland or from other places. They serve as certificates of good quality, international quality. Well, for those graduates from the Hong Kong Chinese, Hong Kong U or Hong Kong Chinese University, they would display their training abroad. Well, how high is it that the same trained non-local doctors cannot practice here? And in fact, the Hong Kong medical faculties have followed the same sort of training from the from abroad. Why is it that those foreign trained doctors cannot practice here? So I think we should revert back to the old regime and eliminate all the barriers for the non-locally trained doctors and do away with the local trained doctors' hegemony. Otherwise, 150 one-way permit and a non-local doctors being barred from practicing here, the situation could only deteriorate. The HKAPI, we represent 30 international institutions, and we provide drugs. Well, apart from increasing resources, we should use the resources properly. However, redundant structures could only be a burden to the personnel. For instance, there are four processes to be included in the drug formulary. There should be a first recommendation, and after inclusion into the formulary, the clusters should review them according to their own needs. The investigation we have done that the whole process could take 34 months, which would take up a lot of time and personnel, and that would be a delay in the use of drugs. There's also clinical tests. In public hospitals, the clinical tests, if they are cross clusters, then we have to go to the different committees for review in the different hospitals. For instance, but however, I cannot see that there would be a great difference for the Hong Kong West or for the Kowloon East. So we should not have redundant tests or reviews. I hope that you will simplify this process and do away with redundant tests so that the medical personnel can really do the work of treatment. As for the public hospital, we should encourage PPP so that resources can be better used. For instance, the pharmacist at the HA have put out the capping of the drug prices, and also there's a way in which that money should be paid when the drug is proved to be effective. That's also a way means of reducing costs. Mr. Leung Kin Ping, Dr. Leung Kin Ping, I'd like to speak on two points. As a patient for the Princess Wales Hospital and the Princess Margaret Hospital, I can see that doctors are very busy in these hospitals. However, they have been very attentive to the patients. Well, they give their consultation, they bring their students, they prescribe medicine, and once they have made the rounds, they go to the outpatient ward. If there is a problem, then they would admit us to the hospital, and they would make arrangements for other doctors to see us, or If in case we need surgery, there would be the surgeon, there would be an anesthetic doctor. They would give us a very thorough explanation to do away with our doubts and fears. And once this surgery is done, nurses have been very attentive as well. I had fever once. I was about to be discharged, but the nurse said that, well, you still have a fever, it's dangerous. But if you come back to the emergency ward, a fever would not be treated as a very serious matter. So it's better for you to stay in the hospital and to place yourself under observation. So doctors have been responding very clearly to our questions, and we have every confidence in the doctors. I'm also a member of a quality and standard group. Every time in our meetings, doctors also attend meetings. We have been very serious in controlling risks, and we have been looking for ways and means of reducing risks in order to increase the level of safety. Some would say that doctors should not work in the HA headquarters. I think headquarters and clusters pay a lot of attention to strategy. I myself also participated in the clinical planning of hospitals. Thank you.
Next. Mr. Ko Yu Cheng. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Good evening, Professor Chen. I'm a chronic patient. I'm also a volunteer working at hospitals. I would like to tell you about the outpatient service for elderly people. For those age 65 or above, for them to use the A&E department's service and the specialist outpatient clinics and the internal and the medical wards, they account for the majority of the patients. Many elderly patients have complained that they have to wait a long time. Usually, on average, they have to wait for 2 hours in a specialty outpatient clinic. But then they, on average, get 2 minutes when they see a doctor. Now, doctors have impaired hearing capacity, and their eyesight is also poor. So within two minutes, it will be difficult for them to express themselves clearly and tell the doctor as to what his complaint is about. Doctors don't have enough time to give to patients. So I've got the following to say. I just wonder if the hospital authority can take up the following proposal. Now, elderly patients have to wait for a long time. While they are waiting, can you not ask somebody to make inquiries with the elderly patients, find out about their conditions, and then the healthcare worker will collect the information, and then the doctor will have some initial information about the latest conditions of the patient, and then the doctor can follow this up immediately. I believe that such an arrangement would mean that within a short period of time, the doctor will get a lot of information, and we all understand that doctor's time is really precious. And in this way, the elderly patients will have sufficient time to fully express himself or herself. By asking other healthcare professionals to collect the information, it means that we are sort of playing a complementary role in the quality of in the service provided to the patients. Next, Ms. Locke, kidney patients self-help group in the Eastern District. I'm a carer, I'm also a patient, and I speak from such a capacity. Well, human beings are bound to fall ill. Before I came, I tried to think about this question, that is whether I want to live till the age of 120. If I'm not healthy, I don't want to live that long. I also asked myself this question, that is, in what way would I like to leave this planet? I came to the conclusion that I would like to do it with dignity, that is, a good death. And I have to count on the government and the hospital authority to help me to make sure that I'm healthy, and when I fall ill, I will be given treatment. Now, for the hospital authority, it has got a 10-year hospital redevelopment project. The first one has been completed. So we have been told that there has been some progress. The second 10-year project will commence. But we don't have many decades in one's life. And we desperately want the hospital authority to be reformed quickly so that you will bring more benefits for the to the patients. Now, the hospital authority has got enough money, sufficient money, other than in addition to raising the pay of the staff members, we should also set aside the resources to boost the service for the patients. Pay rise and increases in allowances. We hope the doctors have a better sort of pay package. But then what about their workload? I think doctors still have a very heavy workload in terms of the number of patients that they have to see. But of course, they have some allowances. But what about the ward attendants who have to undertake obnoxious duties? A lot has been said, and you've got many good suggestions. But still, I would advocate the need to take up preventive work. Would you like to consider the idea of physical examination being provided universally so that we can detect our problems earlier and perhaps we can save on future medical costs? So I hope you can commit more resources in that direction. Next, Mr. Wen. No, not present. Then from the New Democrats, Mr. Feng Guan On. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A few points for the Secretary. I'm sure she must have heard the following. That is, the staff members are suffering from low morale. They are nurses, doctors, and other health professionals. Their mission is to help the patients to save lives. I don't think they should be left to have a fighting mentality. And they have to worry about being so tired that they would make a mistake. This is really undesirable. And yet they work under such conditions day in, day out. I know a doctor working in a A&E department of a public hospital has been approached by a private hospital to change his job. Not that he doesn't like more money, but he knows that when manpower is so inadequate, if he chooses to leave, that means that more patients will have to wait a longer time, and then some patients may suffer unnecessarily. Doctors have to pay ward visits, go to see patients, and then go back to the wards, etc. If on the way, a doctor is asked to stop and explain a patient's conditions to the family members, then he won't even have sufficient time to have a proper meal. So he has to carry out his duties at the expense of his own health. So every day it seems that he's working in a battlefield and he doesn't have time to care for his own health. Now, doctors and nurses are sort of overstretching themselves. Now, it is said that nurses should be trained to ease the burden of the doctors, but who will come to the help of the nurses? So it is only a myth. Now, in Hong Kong, it isn't just a matter of more money for the hospital authority and then the problem will go away. In fact, by giving them more money, it means that they have to shoulder more blame, they will be under more stress. What you have to do is to resolve the problem at root. Increase the supply of manpower. Many young people would like to stay in the medical sector, but then we haven't got sufficient training places. The government should get more resources to increase the number of places in the medical schools. Otherwise, merely giving more money to the hospital authority would only add to the burden. I have had this experience of staying at a hospital. Whenever senior staff members are visiting the wards, then the ward attendants have to spend half a morning's time to move away the furniture in the corridor in the wards. Well, I had this personal experience. I think the senior staff members should go to the wards and stay there as a patient themselves rather than donning a facial mask and do the ward visit. Many of us have been asked to leave, to go away and not cause trouble. Well, we have got a shortage of 300 doctors. That's what I've been told. Well, I tried to dig up the information. In the year 2012-2013, 250 was the number of shortage, and then 300 was the number given in another year. The wastage rate is 4%, 5.8%, etc. Now, we have got an organization which is huge, 6,000 doctors. If the wastage rate is 300 only, and yet you say that the problem is serious, then I think you shouldn't blame the HA. It's not that they don't want to recruit more doctors. Even if they can get another 300 doctors, they haven't got the money to pay the doctors. So it all boils down to planning. I'm not blaming anybody, but planning is important. What was the basis of planning in the past? Did you listen to the doctors, nurses, pharmacists, citizens, patients? So my first point is, let's be honest and frank, let's have a meeting, discuss the problems and seek a solution. And secondly, the health bill takes up 17.5% of the government expenditure. You need to increase the amount of money given to the HA. Otherwise, if you get two or three more Dr. Leung Pak Yin, you can't resolve the problems. Now, I think we need an increase in the service in the general wards. Many patients can't afford to see a private doctor, so they wait for the disease to go away, but at the end of the day, they have to go to a hospital. By addressing the problem, it can save it can ease the burden on the A&E department. When I read the newspaper, then I was surprised to see that the staff members receive a very low level of pay. That's why it is not an attractive job. Now, if we get a prescription filled by a pharmacist, then it means that for chronic patients like us, we don't have to visit the doctor. We can just get the medicine and that's it. And then it is said that most of the A&E department patients go to see a doctor for 4 or 5 kinds of conditions. So maybe they should be taken care of by those specialties instead of the A&E doctors.
Wong Fun Oi, Mrs. Wong Fun Oi. I have been to the hospitals during the last 20 years. I am an eye patient, and of course, I go back for consultations, repeated consultations. And I've seen ophthalmologists leaving and going away. Well, if I know that doctor and see him for often, we have good communication. He doesn't have to look at the file again. But very often, I have seen so many doctors leaving. So ophthalmologists really have a lot of wastage. I've also been admitted into a hospital. I have seen supporting staff, those who are pushing the beds, etc., and the nurses, etc. They are really doing their own jobs. For a patient, any staff in the hospital is of the same importance. We know that supporting staff, there's a great gap between salary of supporting staff and the top professionals. I think that the gap should be narrowed and even evened out. Now, when I came into the Legical Complex, I had to undergo security checks. And I got a badge, and I went for, I sat in to listen in, and in the corridors, there were lots of security guards. At the top of the stairs and in the corridors, there were lots of security staff, and. I had to go through the security check again when I came here. So there were lots of checks repeatedly. So I can also see that it would be the same thing, the whole complicated process for the recruitment of doctors, nurses, etc. I hope that the process can be simplified for non-locally trained doctors so that they can come and as soon as possible serve our public hospitals. We spend a lot of waiting to see the doctor, and then we spend a lot of time waiting for the prescriptions to be provided. So I hope that there should be a choice between hospital pharmacy and community pharmacy. I am a parent of a relative of patients, and we are an NGO, and I have put out a declaration for signature. We know that cancer patients very often have to pay a lot for very highly priced drugs, and very often they had to queue up also for consultations. For poor patients, they have to go and find out if they can find funds for subsidies. Because drugs are so different, doctors and social workers avoid telling us the price of the drugs. For them, if they don't know how much they have to spend, that will only prolong their anxiety. They have to ask a lot of questions. They have to queue up, and they have to wait 1 or 2 months before they can find out what the price are and whether they can afford it or not. very often the delay is leads to very dire consequences. Well, if you want to take a cab to the hospital to the airport, you would need to know how much you are to spend. So they need to know how much they are going to spend. Sometimes they even have to sell their flats. For the pharmacist in the US, for instance, they would tell you how much you have to spend. However, the drugs, prices are very opaque in Hong Kong. Pharmacists in Hong Kong the supply and demand. There's lots of demand and not enough supply. So the community pharmacist led is not a lot of reform. So we hope that the cancer patients can have a better planning with respect to the treatment, and we can also promote PPP through such drug-related measures. The physiological society for community for the physiological associations, Mrs. Simei, we are worried about the physiotherapist situation. First of all, the structure of deployment of physiotherapist, because it is concentrated in the inpatient service, and it is calculated according to the beds. However, we know that there are 1.4 million outpatients, there is no deployment of physiotherapists for these outpatients. There's such a lot of work that we cannot manage. So we can see that the number of outpatients are increasing. According to the end of last year, for new patients for physiotherapists, the patients have to wait 33 months, even up to 45 months. And during this waiting time, they suffer a lot, and that also adversely impact on their recovery. It could also be a deterioration that lead to admission in hospital. Secondly, that's the problem of remuneration. However, the HA is recruiting us according to the diploma level, not according to the degree level. And it is because of this disrespect for their qualification that young physiotherapists are leaving the HA. And we have now a gap in the services. First of all, you have to reform the existing system so that you would have physiotherapists for the outpatients, so that you can recruit enough physiotherapists to boost the morale and increase increase the service. So you should now respect the qualification by paying them according to their degree and not according to the diploma. 40% of physiotherapists are in the private sector, and we think that there's not enough recruitment for the public hospitals. So I think that PPP is the way forward to reduce the burden of public hospitals. HA should also have some new service plans and accept them, because in abroad there are other models that prove to be successful. Using old methods would not solve our problems. Mr. Choi Yik-kung, I have made a written submission. I'm not going to read it. I will reiterate that apart from technical problems, there are political problems, because political problems would attract attacks. Well, I would like to give you two examples. My father, take for instance, and they would say that they should have a pipe inserted to the throat. They proposed that, well, my father died a month later, and he suffered a lot. Well, that also is a wastage of resources. Well, the patient in the next bed did not have a pipe inserted, and he went away the next day, but he didn't suffer. Now, for dentist service, we hope that the public clinics should have the token issuing tokens for the order of consultation. HA faces the manpower problem, which is not new. Well, broadly speaking, the government doesn't have a basic population measure or policy. You allow 150 immigrants a day. We are suffering from that. Well, these new immigrants are not all elderly people, but they also face a problem of disease. I don't say that we do not treat them. However, if we cannot treat our own people, but why should you have 150 immigrants which you have no control whatsoever? If they are the immigrants of one-way permit, and this would aggravate the situation in the medical field. There was one case of a male medical worker burnout, and he died suddenly. So we are now in a breaking point. I think the administration should squarely face that. Now, the new budget are giving 80.6 billion as with an increase. However, the World Bank for the statistics, they should have 7 or 10% of the GDP for medical services. If you calculate the 80 billion against the GDP, it's only 2.8%, which is at level with Sri Lanka, etc. In Cambodia, you have 5.9% of the GDP for medical service, two times what we have. Aren't you ashamed? When would you raise these GDP percentage on medical service so that we would not be ashamed? So you are providing first class medical service with the third country resources. We have very, very valuable medical professionals. Well, they are working with their own conscience, but you should not rely only on their loyalty and commitment. I don't think that increasing the resources is the way to go. Well, they have increased a 26% raise for the top management. Well, where they go back to the mainland for academic exchanges, and they would invite the medical personnel for snacks. Well, you should reduce the one-way permit numbers, and you should have raised the remuneration of frontline staff. Mr. Lee Kwok-kong, I am a chronic patient with a back problem. The specialty treatment, you have to wait 2-3 years for consultation, and there are long queues for radiation therapy, etc. And if something happened during the waiting period, then that's it. If you have a problem, then if you have money, you can go to the private clinic. But what if you don't have it? So you should review this existing medical system. You should look at the population and the age distribution. You should have a long-term medical policy. Well, the wastage of doctors is about 6%. However, for radiography, it's a two-digit attrition rate. If you do not have timely diagnosis, then consequences could be very serious. So you should have a timely diagnosis. So we should have PPP and stream the poor patients to the private practices. Now, you in the community itself, solve the problems that would not need admission into hospitals. We hope that you would be compassionate and be in the patient's shoes to solve their problems. Mr. Li, wait, you. Well, the aging population has been aggravating the medical demands that exceed the supply. Well, first of all, for the manpower, yesterday the Medical Council has put out an investigative report pointing out that there's a shortage of doctors, in particular in public hospitals. We have always pointed out that we should have more imports of qualified, non-locally trained doctors or those that trained abroad to come back and practice here. So there's a consensus here. However, there is one point that I would like to point out. Whether these doctors, when they have completed 3 years in public hospital, and when they have passed exams, should they need to have an internship as well? If you look at the investigation result, it is still insisting that they should stay 3 or 6 years in the hospitals. After 3 years of service in the public hospital, if you add that all up, it's about 9 years, and that is not very attractive. If these doctors, when they have completed 3 years service in the public hospital and passed the exams, you should give them the choice whether they should stay in the public hospital or in the private practice. Now, we have raised a lot of questions in this session and the last. Well, we have a shortage of manpower and a high rate attrition. Well, the service should be very poor. However, if you look at the KPI, the service is not too bad. Well, there are, for instance, for the A&E, the service is not really fulfilling the targets. Well, does that reflect the dissatisfaction? Well, we should look at the review, the KPI itself. I hope that the administration or the top management should understand the problems faced by the frontline staff so that problems can really be solved. In the review conducted in the AHA, well, is it that we have not made a lot of progress in such a way that we are still facing the same problems?
Opportunity to make a few remarks on behalf of our Hong Kong Foundation. Our public healthcare system is on the verge of collapse. In November 2018, our foundation launched a policy research report highlighting complex system-wide changes that need to be developed and implemented in our health system to make it fit for purpose in the 21st century. We advocate for moving towards a primary care-led, integrated, and person-centered system that adequately meets the needs of our population. Amidst the many challenges we need to tackle to improve our system, the issue of shortage in doctors remains unresolved. In 2017, approximately 1.9 fully registered doctors served every 1,000 people in Hong Kong. This number is well below the OECD average of 3.4, and we lag behind many of our international peers. In fact, we need an addition of approximately 3,000 doctors to catch up with the ratio in Singapore. Our public hospitals remain understaffed and the doctors serving them are overworked. Scattered efforts have been made to address the shortage in doctors, although evidently with limited effectiveness. It is our view that due consideration needs to be given to becoming more receptive towards augmenting the role of foreign-trained doctors in our public healthcare system. As of now, two pathways exist that allow for foreign-trained doctors to practice in Hong Kong, and both have room for greater flexibility to attract foreign-trained talent. For full registration, individuals must pass a licensing exam for which internship experience is a listed prerequisite, a potential barrier for graduates from medical courses that do not offer relevant experience. Applicants must also complete a period of post-exam internship training that cannot, like in other jurisdictions, completely be substituted with equivalent overseas experience. The comparatively less accessible examination resources here also potentially deter applicants from succeeding in their application. Individuals applying for limited registration are not required to sit a licensing exam, but they also do not naturally progress to full registration. This contrasts with a clear progression track leading to full registration for non-exam pathways observed in other jurisdictions, such as Singapore. Also limiting the attractiveness of this pathway is the explicit requirement for doctors to continuously be registered with a medical authority elsewhere. It is in the best interest of our crippling public healthcare system, our healthcare workforce, and our citizens that we must review these pathways to encourage the uptake of more well-qualified foreign-trained doctors. This is not the only solution, nor do we claim it to be the best, but it is an important one to move our health system forward from one that is plagued by chronically overloaded inpatient wards, manned by chronically overworked doctors in public hospitals. Thank you again for your time.
Next,
Dr. Lee. I represent the Tumun Hospital doctors. I think there are five major problems. First of all, specialty outpatient clinics. They are getting more and more important. A lot of the health services have been moved from the hospital setting to the community setting. But then the hospital authority would only be planning on the basis of hospital beds. Without new wards, you are not going to get additional manpower. And as a result, you have to wait for a longer time at the outpatient clinics. As a result of the lack of manpower, patients have to wait a long time. You waste a lot of time waiting for your turn to see a doctor. It is indeed difficult. For oncology department at Tumen Hospital, usually you have to see patients until 8 p.m. Patients wait for a few hours and yet they get a few minutes with the doctor. It is unfair to doctors as well as patients. Well, there was a discussion among doctors. For an established case, 13 minutes and then 20 minutes or so for new case. That should be the benchmark, but I don't think we're able to do that. And then for hospital wards, we are always running over the capacity. In fact, there are limits as to how many beds we can operate, but then I'm sure you can tell that we are admitting more patients than we can cope with. And then for the internal ward, as the medical ward, as well as the pediatric ward, there are always more patients than we can cope with. And yet we do have more doctors in response. And then we haven't got enough time to train specialist doctors, so we're losing the doctors to the private sector. The HAA should have a good training program to make sure that frontline doctors are adequately trained. There is also the problem of different pay among different doctors. If you have the same job, but then just because you are under the old system, you may have a different pay package. So frontline doctors find that it is an unfair arrangement. And then non-clinical work. If you work at the frontline, you have to spend a lot of time on writing up medical reports. For our senior management, they have to spend a lot of time on annual planning. If we are able to spend such time on clinical work for patients, it would have generated a much better outcome. A medical graduate may graduate with a lot of passion, but then he is not able to do what he has wanted, and so he's discouraged, and he would leave the hospital authority to go into the private sector. I think you need to address this problem, the problem at root. You have to make sure that the doctors can still be true to their own missions. Thank you for making the journey to come all the way from Tuen Mun. Mr. Tang, Hong Kong Hospitals Employees Association. Well, the hospital authority has standardized the pay rise. It is 8%. Well, we welcome this, but with reluctance. Not all supporting staff will benefit from the pay rise. HCA, Ward A, clerical staff, workman 2, etc., under the older system will not benefit. On the 6th of March, the hospital authority has given a commitment, and then we prepared a questionnaire, and we asked all the supporting staff to fill out the questionnaire. Within a short period of time, we got 2,500 returns. A lot of them have very strong opinions. We have already submitted the findings to the HA as well as the Health Services Panel. We would like to use this as the basis to seek an improvement. Well, for our questionnaire, I think the findings show that for our supporting care-related staff, yes, there is a 5% 8% increase in the pay. 38% of the respondents do not accept the new policy. Our views are divided. Well, for the junior level supporting staff, I think the HA has overlooked the interest. Whether the 8% pay rise can readdress the problem, we have to wait for the outcome to be observed. But we can see that the staff members under the older system are suffering. They have weathered through the SARS as well as other difficult times. But the hospital authority has forgotten the fact that we were asked to receive a pay cut so as to survive the storm. Now, from the speed of responding to the questionnaire, you can see that what a clerical staff, workmen to HCAs, etc., have become very angry because they haven't got a pay increase, though they're doing the same work as those who are going to receive a pay rise. I hope you will understand the sentiments of those who have been neglected. Pay cut during SARS. After SARS, you don't care about us. Thank you. Thank you, deputations and individuals, for expressing your views. Well, for our meeting, we're supposed to end by 8:45, so I exercise my power to extend the meeting by no more than 15 minutes. If we can end earlier, so be it. So I'd like to give the floor to the administration to give an overall reply to the deputations. I'm not going to impose a time limit on you. I think you've got sufficient time. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to thank all the participants for coming here and providing us with a lot of valuable comments. For this session, I see a lot of patient representatives and patients' family members. Many of you have been the users of hospital authority services, and you've told us what you think. And then we have got hospital authority staff members and ex-staff members, and you are telling us about your own stories. Let me answer the points one by one, and I'm sure Dr. Leung from the hospital authority may also want to give a reply. A lot of you have commented on the resources, saying that the government has provided resources to the HA. Well, if you have read the latest budget, that is the budget for 2019-2020, then you know that we are providing $69.9 billion to the HA. When compared with the previous year, it is an increase of 8.5%. So that's the amount of subvention we give to the HA this year. Other than the recurrent subvention, we are also providing $700 million to boost the staff morale. Mainly speaking, this is for different grades, and that's what we are doing right now. And then some of you mentioned what was done in the past. Well, resources have been increased, number of doctors has been increased, but as to how come that we still have to face the problem that we face today, I'm sure you have convinced us that better planning is important. The population is aging rapidly, and then for the patients, they have got different needs. Their cases are getting more complicated, they stay in hospitals longer, the total number of patients is larger, and they also need help when they return to the community. All of them are integrated. Well, in fact, every year, you can see that for the year 2017-2018, we provided service to 22 million attendants, ward services, outpatient clinic service, etc. So the volume is huge, and in addition to adding to our staff establishment, and it appears that we are not catching up with the increase in the demand for our service. Well, for the hospital authority, it is coping with the existing demand as well as introducing new services, and they have also added to the number of hospital beds. Of course, medical technology has advanced, and the hospital authority would like to move with the times, and for the administration, we'll continue to support our public health sector. We will provide the resources needed. Just now, some speakers said that, yes, resources have been given to the hospital authority. And it is the job of the hospital authority to make good use of the resources and to make sure that the frontline staff members can feel that more resources are available. We have got over 70,000 staff members, and they are in different clusters, different hospitals, working in different grades, in different wards, at different ranks. I'm sure they have got a lot of communication, but at the same time, there may be a lot of issues. The HA is working on, say, for example, human resources. Just now, many of you mentioned about the problem of morale. Morale, of course, has to do with workload and the manpower level. The HA currently is devising medium-term and long-term work. Of course, they are introducing short-term measures as well. It is hoped that in the medium-term and the long-term, frontline doctors, nurses, pharmacists, physiotherapists, and other support staff members who have given us advice and suggestions will be given the assistance that they need. All of them are important assets. They are important in the process of healing and treating the patients. They all play an important role. So the hospital authority is going to continue to work very hard to achieve that mission.
Some of you have pointed out that prevention is better than cure. And in our policy, especially this administration, is promoting primary health care. Apart from raising the standard of health, we have also paid attention for the discharged patient so that for chronic disease, better care can be provided for them, whether it be nursing or physiotherapy or drug administration. We hope for better service. Well, we need to have family, a doctor, which plays an important role. In fact, That is indeed so for community care. So we should do our utmost in that we have better community care instead of going to hospitals. Family doctors or the community care should be better. And we are going all out for such service. In September, we have a regional health center. The first one would be in Kwaitung, and that will spread to the other 17 districts. I think you should keep an eye on such development. As for, only one or two more minutes, because there are questions by members that they wish to raise. Mr. Pan Hongcheng raised that question that the Medical Council has put out an investigation report on the optimization of ways and means of attracting non-locally trained doctors. One recommendation is that after passing the exams, perhaps there will be no need for internship. Well, that is to be decided by the Medical Council. We have listened to such an idea. We have consulted the medical associations and societies and the Medical Council how to solve the manpower problem. Apart from the HA itself, we are thinking of being more attractive to encourage non-locally trained doctors to come to Hong Kong. Maybe the HA has something to add? Dr. Leung. Well, briefly, I'd like to thank the administration. This administration has increased resources to us. So in 2018-2019, resources have been increased. And this will be helpful to retain personnel and to help promotion of staff. For instance, the for the nurses as well as for the doctors. I think that after all this work, things would improve. As for facilities, we would be able to rebuild or renovate hospitals so that we can improve on the environment. That cannot be done in a year or two, but prospects are good. As for different grades, for instance, for the doctors, well, a colleague has just said that we are only calculating the wards, but we are also increasing manpower in specialty wards. As for the deployment of pharmacists, we will and also allied supporting staff. Well, we would also like to have their role played. We will have flexibility in that. For frontline staff and for the patients, we have continued our communication. We would not prevent people from speaking up or from going back on them once they have spoken up. So once they have voiced their opinion, what we can do, we'll do. There are three members who would like to ask questions. Mr. Lei Kok-Lun. Well, we have sat through the two sessions as from 5 o'clock. There are friends of patients. There are also frontline staff. Well, the most important thing is manpower shortage. The second is poor governance. That is why there's bullying or heavy workload or paperwork. Even if you add remuneration, people are still unhappy because it's unfair. And for the patients, even though pay service is quite good, but the waiting time is too long. So the secretary and the Dr. Leong have responded in a way saying that all can be solved. The secretary and the Dr. Leong have given 70 billion for the recurring expenses. There are also earmarked funds. There are 6 billion are earmarked. 7 billion is to boost the morale. 1 billion is for drugs, and 5 billion are for equipment. Now, well, people have raised issues, and the response has been positive. In 2020, the budget would be implemented. Well, 3 months later, could you give us an action plan so that the earmarked funds can really be implemented? You have 69 billion recurrent expenses. I hope that you won't squeeze the staff. However, for earmarked funds, how can they go down to the front line? Because very often they said that we could not. It's invincible. Well, the money were not spent in the past on stress points. Where had the money gone? Well, so 3 months later, we should know where they are spent. So you have to oversee how the money is spent, whether it's action plan. So we also would have a monitoring role to play. Well, you have such a plan, and you have to tell us how the money is spent. And we'll ask the front line whether they can see that the money is well spent. Well, since you have earmarked funds, and we will also oversee such funds. So I hope that government or the HA can come back to us and report to us how the money is being spent. Mrs. Zhang Lai-wan, the governance should be improved. A doctor mentioned that too many doctors are in administrative work. An administrative management structure should be changed after a certain period of time. So we need another expert opinion for the enhancement of administration. Doctors, beds, and nurses will continue the shortage in the foreseeable 10 years. We should retain staff, increase training, and do away with internship for non-locally trained doctors. I have been in management for a long time. I know that what I've heard wouldn't work. I'm very worried indeed. Here, I think it is necessary that we should seriously think about increasing the number of staff. For instance, some of our children have gone to be trained abroad, and we should allow them to return. 10 years ago, Singapore faced the same serious problem, but they have now recruited over 1,000 doctors from abroad. We should learn good experience and learn from it. As for the budget itself, it is still insufficient. About 10 years or more ago, we have education, welfare, and medical service. They are the three equal parts. However, education is more than 50% more than yours. You have 80 billion, whereas they have about 550 billion. Now, a doctor, well, his son could not afford the drugs, and the drugs were not available. So I'm very distressed with this case, I would implore the Secretary and the HA top management to seriously consider the questions that we have raised. Okay, the Chairman, I'll have 2 minutes. I have gone to the statistics of 30 years ago. We can see that the beds have decreased from 29,000 during SARS to 28,000 of number of beds. So over the dozen year, the beds have been reduced. So we have reached a breaking point. Now, I will thank the government and the HA. I'd asked about the internal medicine beds. Why is it that we are imploding? Why? Well, you have no beds. Not every hospital has reduced beds during this period. Some hospitals, Prince of Wales and Tuen Mun Hospital, have all increased the number of beds. Queen Mary has the same number of beds. So we can see that some hospitals have reduced the number of beds, including the UCH and Kwong Wah Hospital and Princess Margaret Hospital. So if you see this breaking point, hospitals are Princess Margaret, UCH, and et cetera. So in the last 10 years, in the Kowloon East Kwun Tong area, they have built 7 new estates. The UCH have not increased the beds, but have instead reduced the number of beds. So that is why it is at bursting point. So I'd like to raise a point. For the HA on the HB, who are the persons responsible for planning? Well, we know that in the police department, they have one responsible for planning. And for the HA, and for the FHB, who is responsible for planning?
Mr. Chairman, you want to know about the planning and development of hospitals? Yes, the hardware and the hospital beds. Mr. Chairman, I think you know that since the previous term of the government, we introduced the 10-year hospital redevelopment project costing $200 billion. The hospital authority had its annual plan and strategic plan to see which hospital will be redeveloped. I'm not going to overrun. We have the final 50 seconds. You cannot explain why you cut the number of hospital beds despite having 7 more housing estates. I'm not going to pursue. We have to come to an end. So we have to wind up now. Let me say this again. I thank you again for coming here to express your views to us. I'm grateful to the Secretary, the Permanent Secretary, and the senior management from the hospital authority. Thank you for spending so much time to have an exchange with us. AOB, if there isn't anything on the AOB, meeting adjourned. Thank you.